good to see everyone here. As he said, my name is James Frost. I am a lawyer, and I'm also the director for Show Me Accessible Healthcare, which should be on the screen here in a moment. Before I start my presentation, I would like you to remember that this is about creating accessible healthcare system, how you can participate in that, and help in creating that accessible healthcare system. Skills thought we won. And that's what I want to do, try to help you empower yourselves. We have a lot of power. Right now in Missouri, there's about 90,000 deaf and hard of hearing people who use sign language, and about 250,000 deaf and hard of hearing people in Missouri. So that's a large number. So we have a lot of power. But we just haven't used that power yet. We need to become empowered so that we can become more effective in the healthcare system. All of us will be patients at one point or another. We will always go to hospitals, doctor's offices, dental offices, psychiatrists, etc. All of us. So we all need to become empowered, right? That's pretty cool. We're here at the Deaf Empowerment Symposium, which is perfect. The perfect time to talk about health care at the Deaf Empowerment Symposium. So it's really the first step is I'm going to give you the facts. We recently heard Valerie, and she made her presentation about her research. That's fantastic, right? Great. But is that enough? What do you think is enough? Do you think it is or no? Right, it's not, because that's only one small piece of the research. But many other people have also been doing research. So I'm going to show you what research is like, but first I wanted to show you. This is all the research that I found on the internet, and there's even more of this. This is just a small piece of it. But you can see how thick this file is. So we have a lot of research, and also we had a health care forum on May 18th, 2013 in St. Louis, Missouri, and we had about 89 people that showed up, so we collected 46 stories on video. People were coming up in front of the forum and sharing their stories, and they were very impactful. One thing that we found from that, we had a town hall meeting September 21st, 2013 in Sykeston, Missouri. So we drove down there, and we were planning on talking about our organization, but what ended up happening was pretty incredible. People stood up, and they shared their experiences and their stories. And I'll talk more about that town hall meeting. So let's get started. Are you ready? And you see the quotes up here. There were two researchers, Helen Meader and Philip Zetzo. And they wrote a paper on healthcare for the deaf and hard of hearing and what's happening within the deaf community. So the first thing I want to point out to you is the quote that's up there. It talks about certified ASL interpreters. Why do people prefer certified ASL interpreters? Because that means that they've been trained, and the deaf person can feel relieved in knowing that this person knows ASL, they know how to change all of those concepts that they're hearing. those from those language groups are also doctors and nurses, but how many deaf doctors do we have? We have very, very few. How many deaf nurses do we have? Very, very few that are from our language and our culture. So it's a struggle for us to be able to find a healthcare provider that is of our language and our culture. This leads to communication breakdowns. Those who are from other countries or immigrants, well, they're able to find medical professionals who are from their language and culture group. So therefore, they're at less risk than deaf. The next book is talking about when deaf and hard of hearing people go to the store and they're pushing their cart through the store and there's an announcement. Often they will have an announcement about maybe healthcare information, something that's happening at the pharmacy, etc. And hearing people are able to take advantage of that information. And that could be something that they learn, something that sparks interest in them. But deaf people miss out on that. So then what happens is we don't have as much healthcare knowledge as hearing people do. The next quote is very true. In the article, they talked about a case where a deaf mother put oral liquid antibiotics in her daughter's ear instead of giving it orally. Because the child had an ear infection, so they thought that the medication went into the ear. So obviously there was a communication breakdown. And it's not just deaf people, it's also hearing people, hearing children, hearing parents. They're also at risk. The next quote is the research shows that if a doctor is working with a deaf person and they're trying to meet what their communication needs are, that it is more successful, they have greater patient satisfaction, more compliance with healthcare, and the deaf person is less at risk. They're able to make better decisions about their healthcare instead of the doctor making them. So the researchers made two recommendations that I think you should know about. The first of which says that for hospitals, if you're going to the emergency room, they always give you a paper telling you what your prescription is. But let me ask you, how many of you understand that paper that you get that has your prescription information on it? No hands went up. So that means that deaf people look at that prescription information and they don't really understand what it means. For those who speak another language, for immigrants, hospitals will print that information in their language. So they're able to understand that information. Where is that information presented in ESL? So what I propose is that the hospital should make an ASL video explaining the medication information, and then the deaf person could take a CD and they could watch that information and have a better understanding about that medication. The next quote was talking about before going into the doctor's office with the interpreter. You should find out the name of the interpreter, etc. And then they should tell the deaf person, hey, we have this interpreter lined up for you. This is his or her name. Is this acceptable to you? Because sometimes the deaf people don't trust the interpreter that they're being provided with. Sometimes they meet them and maybe they've heard things about that interpreter that this person is not does not keep information confidential. They're not credible. And so that makes them less likely to be forthcoming in their appointment. Or maybe they have to ask questions and they're afraid that the information is going to be embarrassing and this interpreter is going to spread that information. The next research I want to show you is from Donna Schreiner, which was published in 2000. 2009. And this research is talking about economic barriers, which is true. Because it takes money to hire qualified interpreters. And to spend the time to interact with the deaf and hard of hearing people. Did you know that the average time that the doctor spends with a hearing person is about 15 minutes or less? But with a deaf or hard of hearing person, it tends to take a half hour or 45 minutes for the appointment. So the doctor feels a sense of urgency because time is money. Many people think that misunderstandings happen with the deaf and hard of hearing, only this is not true. And that's what I want all of you to understand, is that we can tell the doctor and say, you know, if you don't provide an interpreter, you may not be able to understand me. And that's something that you need to tell them, to give them that information from their perspective. They may not be able to understand what you're saying. And that's one way that you can advocate for yourself at the doctor's office. If they're not sure about providing an interpreter for you, then you can show them this and show them how it will be financially valuable for them. In the next two sentences here, this speaks about medication errors and misappointments and misdiagnosis or misunderstood diagnosis. So now that we talked about the hearers providing interpretation, maybe the patient is being diagnosed with cancer, and if the son is interpreting, he doesn't want his father to be sad, and so he withholds that information. There's been research shown that there are egregious errors that can occur when family members are interpreting. It could also be that there's a lack of understanding, that family members don't understand what is being talked about. So that could be an issue. Maybe the family member is not proficient in sign language. That also can have very dire impact on the patient's understanding about their own health care. So the common surprises of the healthcare community dire. And you can use this way to communicate the dire consequences. You can use this language to communicate such to doctors. The research article also talked about a case where a man was in the United Kingdom and went into a healthcare setting, and they ended up amputating his left leg rather than his hip surgery. So that was dire. Other times, consequences can actually result in death. So we need to be involved in our health care. This quote I feel like is the most important one in the research. Many research documents have shown that the biggest barrier is the attitude that the doctor or nurse actually look down upon the deaf patient. The deaf patient is often isolated and left alone. So that is the largest barrier. This article is trying to communicate that if medical professionals try to communicate with deaf or hard of hearing patient, it will actually go a long way. Just simply showing respect to the deaf and hard of hearing patient, rather than feeling disrespected and devalued. So respect is the biggest thing that we need to experience. Empowerment is our greatest weapon. This is such a true statement, and there's a lot of research on the internet. You can find it yourselves. If you simply do a Google search and type in healthcare debt research, you will find a number of results. You can also visit www.healthcareinterpreting.org, and there is a great amount of information there. There are also videos on that website. Another site that you can go to is up here on the slide. You are Tonight I'd like to share some information about an organization called the Joint Commission. This is a very important organization that has reviewed over 20,000 healthcare institutions in the United States. It includes doctor's offices, hospitals, a number of institutions. They have a great amount of power for us, and this we need to utilize this power. I'd like to tell you more about why this is. So the Joint Commission published this document. It's a great document. So it's a great roadmap for hospitals and doctors' offices to learn how to achieve best healthcare, not just for immigrants, but also for deaf and hard of hearing people. This document is available on the website, www.jointcommission.org. So the first recommendation they made is to identify the patient's preferred language for discussing healthcare. And what we did was come up with a form that the deaf and hard of hearing patient can complete themselves. They can then share that form with the doctor or the nurse and request that that's placed in their file. That will clearly document their language preference, their communication preference. The next recommended action is assistance in completing admission forms. Now this is good because when we go into an appointment, maybe the emergency room, there's not an interpreter there at the admissions desk. So often the office personnel will try to gesture or write back and forth with us, which is not effective. There's an organization in Minnesota, I think, that's developed a program that is on video. And there is information on this video about an admission form that would be accessible to deaf patients, that they would then be able to understand the process of filling out the form. The next action is that communication assistance to family members whose preferred language is not English to facilitate or enable family involvement in care discussions is there. Now this is critical. Many of us have children. Many of us have parents who are in need of care as they're aging. So this is very important as recommended action, that even though we are not the direct patient, we also have interpreting services provided. The next one is that the hospital should provide pre-recorded sign language video content for patient education. Now this is great, because oftentimes when we go for community education seminars, there's no interpreter provided.
or perhaps something is shared on TV, but captioning isn't always available. There are a number of times that we do not have access to this information. So this recommendation of pre-recorded sign language video content is critical, and it would also be available on So the Joint Commission also published another document. That's what I'm holding up here. This was published in 2007. Most of the document is focused on immigration and immigrants, but there are some that are directly impactful to the deaf community. So I'd like to highlight those at this time. The financial incentives actually should be created to promote, develop, and maintain accessibility to qualified healthcare interpreters. Now that is good for us because perhaps hospitals can provide bonus for providing interpreter training. Maybe hospitals can provide a bonus if an interpreter takes anatomy class. Or another example would be that hospitals could pay for their anatomy class and education and see that that would provide that education. Healthcare interpreters need to be used to enable effective communication during all informed consent processes. So that's good because we want deaf and hard of hearing people to be able to understand the doctor's directions. So if it's a surgical procedure, for example, and written information or printed information is given to the deaf patient, if there is an interpreter present there, the deaf person has access to that information through the interpretation. That is what we need. Also, hospitals need to have a written policy regarding providing language services. This is great for us. Because what that means is that hospitals will have something in writing that protects our communication access rights. So the Joint Commission has a great deal of emphasis on not using family members and interpreters. In the document, it outlines this in detail. It talks about the consequences that will happen if family members are utilized. Family members might be afraid to be the carriers of bad news. So the cancer example that I shared earlier, I mean, if a doctor is informing a patient that they have cancer and they're going through the son of this patient, that son may not want to share that information, especially if the son is 10 years old. Do you think a 10-year-old boy wants to tell his father that he's dying potentially? No. So the Joint Commission has placed heavy emphasis on the fact that family members should not be used to interpret unless there are no other options. Also, hospitals should assess both English and the target language, so in our case, American Sign Language proficiency, and also provide training on the practice of interpreting healthcare settings. This is very important because with regular interpreting, and I'll tell you, like on my job or in other situations, I'll work with an interpreter that is a general practitioner. There's no specific terminology or anything that will come up. It's an interpreter that is competent and certified, right? But let's take it the same scenario or maybe into a medical or healthcare scenario. Let's say we have a highly qualified interpreter. interpreter, comprehensive or master level, and that interpreter is working in a healthcare setting. However, the interpreter lacks information about medically specific terminology and has to continue to ask for clarification. Now that causes pain problems for me as the patient. This interpreter may have excellent interpreting skills but doesn't understand the language that's being used. That's not reasonable to expect. That an interpreter must know this language, right? Is that reasonable? It's not fair to the interpreter. Interpreters should not be placed in situations where they don't have those tools. So we need to help provide that training. Right? This is the terminology that will be used, this is the language that will be used. We need to provide them that training. Once the interpreters have that training, then they can be expected to interpret in those settings. That's what the Joint Commission is saying. So this is good for us. We had a forum on May 18th, 2013. We got 14 organizations to collaborate. When's the last time you saw 14 organizations that serve deaf and hard of hearing population get together and work together as a team? It was impressive. And what's more impressive is that people showed up and shared their stories. That gave us data. It gave us data that we can use to educate and inform hospitals of the problems. All right. So the biggest group of deaf and hard of hearing attendees at that forum, the number one complaint was that the interpreter doesn't show up. There was one person that had a specific situation, the interpreter had a car accident. But the other stories, there was no explanation. There was no reasonable explanation for why the interpreter didn't show up. They simply knew the interpreter didn't show up. Now the thing is, deaf and hard of hearing people all said they made their appointments ahead or they approached the desk in person to make this interpreter request. So this is a big issue. The second largest group of complaints related to not whether or not an interpreter showed up, but it was the qualifications. There was one story that was shared in the healthcare forum. That the interpreter was not expressing accurate information from the patient. So the patient informed the doctor of this. The wife had to interpret for the husband. And the wife was the actual patient. The husband was there accompanying her. So the deaf husband had to depend on his wife, who was the actual patient, to communicate with the doctor. That's not acceptable. That is not right. And that was all because the interpreter was not providing accurate information to the doctor. The other piece is that interpreters will often sit out of the role of interpreting. There was an example where a patient was in a doctor's office, and there was a friend who knew sign language who was there with the patient. And the friend started talking with the doctor, not telling the deaf patient what was happening. So the deaf patient was left unaware of what was happening. So this interpreter, who happened to also be a friend, was not acting professionally. All right, so the results are appointments were canceled multiple times after those interpreters didn't show up. People reported that treatments were delayed because interpreters were either late or waiting in an emergency room for a very long amount of time. One person actually left, publishing to wait 8 hours in the emergency room. The person actually had to leave. Never got service. The next day, she was worse and had to be brought back in an ambulance. Moving on, providers refused to provide interpreters because the participant was a spouse or a caregiver. We had two specific stories about that were very impactful. One person was taking care of his parents. The doctor wouldn't provide an interpreter, so the deaf person was left unaware of how to provide appropriate care to his parents. He felt completely at loss that he couldn't provide care for his parents. These kinds of things happen several times. Doctors or even dentists, other medical professionals, will expect the patient, the deaf patient, to pay for those interpreting services. And oftentimes, the deaf patient will not be able to stand up for themselves. Those kinds of responses devalue deaf people.
So there's a document on the results of the poll from last month, and you can see that on our website. We are soon creating an ASL video because I know a lot of deaf people are not comfortable with reading in English, and so we will be creating an ASL video of that document. So that'll help the deaf and hard of hearing who are not comfortable with reading it in English. That way you can watch the video. So now for the town hall meeting, we went to Sykes, Missouri. And we were with the Missouri Association of the Deaf and also the Missouri Commission for the Deaf and Hard Hearing. We were trying to explain about the three different organizations and what we do. And when it came my turn to present, I was giving my explanation of our organization, and I was really shocked because after my presentation and we had the question and answer time, people were coming up and telling their experiences that they've had in a healthcare setting, which really had a great impact on me. So I asked MCDHH for a copy of it. Let me show you the transcript that we got from that meeting. This is it. And in going through that transcript, we were trying to dive so there were a couple of major issues. One was with having on-site interpreters. We found that hospitals down in southeast Missouri, in that area, are starting to refuse to pay for on-site interpreters. Instead, they want to use VR, video remote interpreting, at the exclusion of on-site interpreters. So the deaf and hard of hearing people are very put out by this. One person, their work was, they took away my choice. They took away, meaning they felt powerless. They felt devalued. And the issue related to VRI, there were several people who said that the screen that was used for VRI was too small. They were not able to see. They couldn't understand the interpreter. Now, you know, in the U.S., we have different diagnoses. So if you're using VRI in Missouri, you may be getting an interpreter that resides in California. And so their signing style has regional differences. So the deaf people have a difficult time understanding the interpreter. They also found that at times the VRI interpreter was unqualified for interpreting the medical setting because they were a newer interpreter or at least a graduate with less experience. They also found that the deafblind individuals were being forced to use VRI, which I thought, are you kidding me? How could deafblind people, I mean, obviously, if you have the word blind there, they're not going to be able to see to use VRI. It's ridiculous. I was shocked by this. How could this be true? People down there said, oh, yes, this has happened several times. Not just one time, several times. Difficult to believe. So now we have the facts. Now we can fight. Okay, we're ready. Right? Are you ready? Are you ready too? Are you excited? So what do you think? Do we have enough facts now to start the fight? How many people say yes? How many say yes? Okay. How many say no? This is my answer. Yes. We do have enough facts. We have enough research, as I've shown you. You can go on the internet and you can find this research for yourselves. Are we ready? What's your answer? How many say yes? How many say no? My answer is no. So what's next?
That interpreter, one of the interpreters, had to arrive there within 30 minutes or less.
but not that.
I would love that, not just for here in Missouri, but as a standard for the entire U.S. That's what I would like to see. That's what we want. That's what we deserve. So we need to remember that it will be a fight, and we're going to have both mountaintops and valleys. It's not going to be a consistent win-win all the time. So we need to have that vision and remember what we're struggling for, what we're fighting for, and our enemy's money. In hospitals, they focus on what the bottom line is. How much is this going to cost me? So they're very focused on budgetary issues. We're going to have to fight against that. We're going to have to show them that interpreters will actually save them money. And ignorance is an issue. Many hospitals don't know about that culture. They've never come up against it. They've never experienced it. So they're scared of it. And they're not experienced. They don't know how to use interpreters. They don't know how to do that. For example, one story that I heard at the health reform, there was an interpreter that was in the setting, and the doctor that was in the room, and the deaf patient who was on the opposite side. The doctor walked into the room and looked at the interpreter and positioned themselves right in front of the interpreter, in between the interpreter and the deaf patient, blocking the view of the interpreter. So the deaf person couldn't see the interpreter. The deaf person had to keep saying, "Excuse me, I need to be able to see the interpreter. Excuse me, you can have me look." It really happened. So we've already started the first battle. We're working with LAMP and with MCDHH about what we would like to see happen. We're also working with LAMP right now to develop a high-quality interpreter training course to help interpreters. The reason why we're working with them is that I'm working with them now. They have 15 years of experience in training and language interpreters in healthcare interpreting. So they have a lot of experience. My executive director at LAMP also teaches mental health interpreting for foreign language interpreters. So they have a lot of experience. So from that experience, they are developing a program to train and sell interpreters. Remember, when we wrote the letter, what did we ask for? We wanted the state to require sign language interpreters to have help their interpreting training before the interpreter goes into the healthcare setting to work. We heard that DMH is working on a proposal, and we want the interpreters that work in the healthcare setting to be similarly qualified. So we want the state to require sign language interpreters to get healthcare specific training certification and continuing education to maintain that certification. When we wrote that letter, we understood that DMH was working to provide a mental health interpreting certification. We found that was inevitable because we had certification for mental health. That means that deaf people who go into the mental health setting, they can feel comfortable knowing that they have an interpreter that has been specifically trained for that setting. But what about the people who go to the dentist, or the people who are going to the doctor's office, or to the emergency room, or into the hospital? We felt that the standards for mental health care were much further above what it was for the regular healthcare setting. We felt that the interpreter should be qualified for any health care setting, whether that's mental health or regular physical health care. We felt that it should be the same. That's what I believe. We're also developing a training course for health care interpreters, for ASL interpreters. I'm working with LAMP on that. It's designed to be a very high quality course. LAMP already has a training course for foreign language interpreters, which is called Bridging the Gap. And I looked over the course, it's very good, but it is very basic. Many of the ASL interpreters already know the information that's contained in that course by the time they finish their interpreter training programs. So there's no point in teaching them what they already know. So what we're doing is we're developing a training course focused on what we can add to that knowledge to advance their level of skill. So we found a good set of recommendations from St. Catharines University and the Katie Center. The reason I'm following their recommendations is that they are the leading experts in healthcare interpreting for the deaf and hard of hearing. And we have one of them who's with us today. It's Richard Lorien. And if you look around on our website, you'll come to the same conclusion that you need to visit that website, www.healthcareinterpreting.org. And it's really got fantastic resources on it. So why are we focusing on healthcare interpreting first? Many of our healthcare decisions can result in serious consequences, sometimes even death. And that's been proven by research and also by our own anecdotal life experiences. So this means that we need to have effective communication with our doctor or with our psychiatrist or our dentist or whoever the healthcare provider is to make sure that we're able to make good healthcare decisions. So the research also showed that if the interpreter was not only certified, but also, and this is actually from one of the papers that I have, also medically experienced, that it resulted in the best communication between the doctor and the patient. So how do we get interpreters to become medically experienced? We have to give them training and the tools that they need to become medically experienced. And that's what we're trying to do. To get them up to speed so that they can then in turn help thousands of people. So by helping the interpreters, we're helping the community all over the country. And that's really important. So in Illinois has a law called the Language Access Service Act, Language Assistance Service Act. And what that requires is simple. Hospitals must post a policy on interpreter access in a public place. So for example, if you were to go into the emergency room, you should be able to see a sign that is there that contains the policy and the contact information. Whom do I contact if I want to request an interpreter? That person's phone number should also be listed. So either you can make a phone call and request services, or you could contact the front desk and ask for that individual's name so that you can go in person.
And
that law also says that if the hospital does not follow that policy, then the state could, this has never happened yet, but it's possible that the state would take away the hospital's license, meaning that they wouldn't be able to operate as a hospital anymore. So it's a pretty powerful tool. We also plan to have more healthcare forums. We have one scheduled for the Springfield, Illinois area on November 8th. And we're planning one for the Kansas City area, which was supposed to be last weekend, but there was a little too much going on, so we had to delay that. We plan that for either December or January. And that'll be in Kansas City. We're also planning one for Springfield, Missouri, or Jefferson City, Columbia, Missouri, Cape Girardeau, Missouri. So we're trying to collect more data. And the reason why we're trying to get that data is because the more data we have, the more credible we appear. That's a very important thing. Because if we want people to trust us, they have to trust that we're not just simply asking for whatever they want. We need to show them that what we want is supported by evidence. So we're planning on getting more people to give us their stories, to give us more data, so we can into the community. so that we can serve more people and be out there with the community. And then this is a bigger goal. We want to start a scholarship program for deaf and hard of hearing students so that they can go to medical or nursing school. We want to raise $750,000 for that. And that's really important because we want to encourage deaf and hard of hearing people to go to medical school. The best communication often happens between a patient and a doctor who speak the same language, instead of having an interpreter in the mix. So there's a famous quote that says something is always lost in the translation, which means if you have an interpreter there, there's always going to be something that's missing. We can't help it. I don't know who said that quote, I forget, but it really is true. It's something that stuck with me. And I remember that for a really long time. And that's why we're we want to have deaf and hard of hearing doctors in all of St. Louis, in Kansas City, in Springfield, in Cape Girardeau, in Jefferson City, or the Columbia area. We want to have them around the state. And also in Illinois, we want to have a deaf or hard of hearing doctor in the Chicago area, in the Springfield, Illinois area, and in southern Illinois. And we want to have at least 5 deaf nurses in each state. We can do it. And it may not be something that happens, I hope we will, we're working on it, but we want to establish a medical center for deaf and hard of hearing people in St. Louis, Missouri. And it would be really cool if we had a place where maybe the doctor isn't deaf, but maybe we could have a cancer doctor that knows sign language, or a podiatrist that knows sign language, or the dentist who knows sign language. They could come together in the same center once a week, and they could see deaf patients. Then they could go back the other days of the week to their regular practice. So that's the vision that I have. I want you to substitute accessibility for excellence in this book. What we repeatedly do, accessibility, therefore, is not an act, but a habit. If we change the healthcare system, the habits they're in, what they normally do every day, if we can change that, then we can build an accessible healthcare system. Do we have any questions? Okay, we have time for questions. Come on up.
Soon. Will there be a variety of signers?
We haven't decided that yet, but we know that it's really important to make sure that the deaf community understands what the results of the healthcare forum were. But there was one paper. Yeah, there was one paper that was written that says that it's very important for deaf health researchers that the community can trust the researcher. If they're telling the results to the community, we know that it's not enough to have it just written on paper, but that we need to have it signed as well.
So you're making sure that the videos will be created with a variety of signers.
I think it's important. important to have a roundtable discussion and have various people involved to talk about the results and everything, so.
Great, thanks.
Other questions?
So while you've been doing this research, I haven't seen mention of certified deaf interpreters. You know, we don't want, I mean, we'd like to be proactive, I think, including certified deaf interpreters, so I'd like to put that out there.
Right, we're not restricted to just an ASL interpreter. So far, people haven't shared any stories about the use of CDIs. So I would encourage you, if you have any stories like that involving CDIs, share those with us, please. Because that would help to increase the accuracy of our results. And the more data that we have, then the more trust we can develop. Any other questions? I do want to say thank you. And before I end, I also want to say thank you to the Missouri Commission for the Deaf and Hard of Hearing for letting us do this presentation and focusing on healthcare for the symposium. And I want to say thank you to Deaf Inc. for videotaping this. I want to say thank you to Deaf Interlink for their sponsorship of this event, and really many of the organizations who have supported us. And I so much appreciate it. Really appreciate your support, and I'm hoping that you will encourage people to share their stories. We have a Facebook page. If you go to Facebook and you search for Show Me Accessible Healthcare, then you'll find that. And if you would, please like the page. We're also on Twitter. Our name on Twitter is Show Me Accessible HC. All right, thank you so much for your presentation.